It's Office Hours Live!
Woohoo!
Thank you, thank you. And we're back 5 weeks before Election Day. And 5 weeks, that sounds like it's a long time, but it's not. I mean, this is a critical election. And please, share right now because I'm live and you're live. And Dolly Parton is not, well, she's not on that tape live, but I'm sure she's around. She still hasn't contacted me. Dolly, I am waiting for you to contact me and at least just say hello and tell me whether you're going to vote for Hillary or Donald Trump. Not sure I want to know, Dolly. But today we're going to talk about Trump's taxes. We're going to talk about tonight's debate, vice presidential debate, and I'm going to take your questions. We're going to do it all in a half an hour, and you're sharing this, and yeah, we're ready to go. We're ready to go, right? Yeah, all right. So first of all, there are a couple of things you need to focus on with regard to Trump's taxes. And one of the things that you need to focus on is that there is a scandal here, but one of the scandals is not just Trump paying, which we think he has not paid. I mean, he hasn't denied it, let's put it this way. There is reason to believe he has not paid any taxes at all for the last 15 years, maybe longer, maybe 18 years. One of the scandals here is that it may have been perfectly legal. That is, the tax code does allow businesses and business people to take what are called tax losses, that is, losses on their operations, and carry them forward. So if Donald Trump actually did lose about $1 billion in 1995, he could take that loss and subtract it for the next forever, I mean not forever, for 18 years, from his income. From his income taxes, which is why there is a reason to believe that he hasn't paid any taxes. And the thing about this that you want to know is that you can do this, particularly if you are a real estate mogul, a developer, because you can deduct your, in fact, you take out big, big loans, all right? And those loans you put into your buying of investment properties. And then if things don't work out, if you lose a lot, what happens? Well, your losses are still counted as losses, even though they're based on big loans, even though you can get tax deductions on those loans, and you probably did take tax deductions on those loans, on the interest on those loans, so you're already double or triple counting. And if your income, by contrast, is as a worker, you get regular income, a salary, you can't do that. You can't take, if you have a low salary 1 year and you have a high salary the next year, you can't average them over the years. You can't do what big, real estate moguls and others whose income is entirely in assets can do. And you also, normal people, don't get the benefits of capital gains. They have to pay normal income taxes on normal income. But people like Donald Trump, obviously, all their income is on the basis of capital gains that is paid at a lower rate than ordinary income. And so you see how the tax code has been loaded. I mean, this scandal, Trump's scandal, is really a scandal of the tax code itself. But the amount that Donald Trump actually took in 1995 in terms of these losses against his income, we're talking about 2% of all operating loss carryforwards in the entire United States. In other words, that year, in 1995, add up all of the operating loss carryforwards that all of the businesses and business people took. Donald Trump's almost $1 billion was 2% of that entire total, himself, for himself, by Trump. So even though this is all legal, and it's a scandal that it is legal, the scale of Donald Trump's non-payment or the use of this particular loophole is unprecedented. Now here's another thing you ought to understand. Trump's responses to all of this. I mean, he's saying, oh, don't worry about it because, for one thing, I'm smart and I'm a genius in terms of the tax code. Can I just tell you something? All Trump did was get some very smart tax lawyers. He doesn't know the tax code. He just hires and pays tax lawyers to do all of this. The second thing he says is he does just what's legal. Can I tell you something else? You have a choice as a business person to either be aggressive. You tell your tax lawyers, your very expensive tax lawyers, I want to be as aggressive as possible. And that aggressive as possible is a signal that means you're going to go right up to the line. You're going to go actually right up to the line, even if it means you're going to be audited, even if it may mean litigation by the IRS. And that's exactly what Donald Trump has done, because he says he's audited all the time. And we know that he is in and has been in litigation with the IRS. So that kind of aggressiveness with regard to basically taking every advantage of every possible, pushing the envelope on taxes, is something that most businesses actually, they don't do, because the risks of getting caught times the penalties, I mean, it doesn't make sense. So that really, he's not smart enough, he's not doing just what's legal. What about, you know, the other thing about Donald Trump, last July in 2015, do you remember what he told the Wall Street Journal? He said, I am a smart businessman because I pay off politicians to get what I need. That's what he said. So it's not only as if he's doing what's legal. He and other real estate developers, and this is particularly true of real estate developers, they have been making for years contributions to politicians who will give them special tax breaks. This is not, the tax code is not just created out of thin air. It's created on the basis of a lot of money that comes into Congress, into the tax writing committees. And Donald Trump has admitted that he was part of this. So it's not just him acting legally, it's him actually changing the laws, participating in changing those laws. And then he says, finally, it's his fiduciary duty. Did you get that yesterday? He said, well, it was my fiduciary duty to take advantage of every conceivable tax break I could because I owe it to my shareholders. What? I mean, for one thing, there is no fiduciary duty with regard to extending and taking every conceivable tax break and tax loophole and creating tax loopholes. Secondly, there is not even in the law anything that requires any CEO of any company to maximize shareholder returns. That's not in the law. I mean, all of this fiduciary stuff is also absolutely baloney. Donald Trump, and here you are again, I can't resist giving you, there he is, and there he is. Donald Trump, what you are doing and what you have said about your taxes makes absolutely as much sense as anything else you have said this entire election. It is self-serving, it is hypocritical, and it makes no sense on top of everything else. Do you get me? Am I making myself clear? Finally, I want to say something about Donald Trump as a businessman. Because he keeps on, and I keep on hearing from the few people that I run across who are still Trump supporters, they say, well, notwithstanding he's a blowhard and he's a narcissist and he's a bigot, still, I think the United States needs a businessman, a good businessman. This entire notion of Donald Trump as a good businessman is itself absolutely 100% baloney. It is based on nothing. It is based on mythology. First of all, how good a businessman can you be if in 1 year, 1995, you lose almost $1 billion? That is not a sign necessarily of a great businessman. Secondly, Donald Trump said in 1976 that he had, when asked what his net worth was, he said his net worth was $200 million. He is now arguing that his net worth is over $8 billion. Well, if he had in the year 1976, just put that $200 million into an index fund and simply automatically reinvested the dividends, today he wouldn't have $8 billion, he'd have $12 billion. In other words, Donald Trump has actually lost himself $4 billion by his own admissions in terms of what he has said he had in the year 1976 and what he has now. He's lost $4 billion from what he'd automatically have if he had just used an index fund. That's a good businessman? Please. Can we leave Donald Trump right now? All right, so we have a vice presidential debate coming up tonight. And that vice presidential debate features two people who don't necessarily have the degree of colorfulness and the kind of penchant for sensationalism that Donald Trump has, and that certainly Hillary Clinton is a character that everybody wants to know more about or has wanted to know more about. So I don't expect that tonight's vice presidential debate is going to attract the kind of audience, which was over 60 and some say closer to 100 million, that we had in the first presidential debate. These characters, Mike Pence, who is the Donald Trump's vice presidential candidate, he's been called kind of a genteel Ted Cruz. Is that right? That comports with everything I know about Mike Pence. Mike Pence is governor of Indiana. He took a lot of money, millions of dollars, from the riverboat gambling industry, and then he made sure a law was passed in Indiana that allowed all of those riverboat casinos, that go right past the state, to actually have their casinos on the land, in state. Well, that's sort of the most extreme example. It's maybe not extreme. It's certainly a typical example of a payoff. In other words, he's a typical governor, particularly Republican governor, who gets paid off by industry. Another thing that you want to know and bear in mind, unlike Tim Kaine, Mike Pence is going to be delegated by Donald Trump. If the worst that happens, Donald Trump becomes president, Donald Trump, knowing him and knowing how he runs his organizations, he is not going to get into any of the details about governing. That means Mike Pence is actually going to be the president. Donald Trump is going to be the front man. Donald Trump is going to be the promoter. Donald Trump is going to be making the big statements. Donald Trump is going to be getting us into trouble. Donald Trump is going to be causing all kinds of chaos. But actually, the detailed day-to-day running of the government is probably going to be given to Mike Pence. So you ought to know about him in the off chance that Donald Trump does become president and Mike Pence has all of that delegation. Also, bear in mind that Donald Trump is 70 years old. Now, that's pretty old, 70-year-old. I mean, 70, I'm 70. I mean, 70, you have to at least consider the possibility, right, that a vice president might step in. Hillary's 68. You also have to consider that possibility with regard to Tim Kaine. These are relatively on the older side of presidential candidates, and therefore vice presidents mean more. The other thing tonight to keep a special watch on is that the questions toward both of them, but particularly toward Mike Pence, are going to be how to justify what Donald Trump has been saying. Michael Pence so far has been kind of a verbal pooper scooper for Donald Trump. You know what I mean? I mean, going around cleaning up the messes that Donald Trump has made. He's going to be asked about Donald Trump's taxes tonight. And so beware there. Tim Kaine is... I don't know him personally. I have heard he is a moderate Democrat. He is not exactly a Bernie Sanders Democrat. He would be a fairly traditional vice president in terms of not delegated all that much because Hillary Clinton knows all of these issues. I'm interested in him answering tonight, honestly, Tim Kaine, is what about the Trans-Pacific Partnership? He has been very supportive of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and he hasn't specifically come out against it, as Hillary Clinton has, so it'll be interesting to know where he stands on all of this. All right, so even if you don't go to the debates tonight, the vice presidential debates, bear in mind that they are important. They are important. Not quite as exciting, maybe, as the other debates, but they are important. Which gets us to your questions. I hope you have a lot of questions today because there are lots going on. 5 weeks, by the way, 5 weeks to Election Day. Betty Moore, do you think the revelations about Trump's taxes will make any difference in his level of support? Betty, with regard to, about 80% of Trump supporters are actually committed Trump supporters. I don't think he could say or do anything that would shake them from their support. But you've got about 20%, according to the polls, who are supporting Trump, who still are saying that they are going to the polls, but are not that committed, are not 100% committed, and I think these revelations could make a difference. Axel Cook, instead of just talking about how horrible Trump is, for not paying taxes for two decades, shouldn't we be talking about closing the loophole that made it legal? Absolutely, Axel. And I think that that is, as I indicated, part of the big scandal with regard to not only the loss carry forward loophole, capital gains advantages, but also the fact that most people who make actually income for a living and don't live off of capital gains can't do any of this. Megan White, tell us more about your recent trip to Canada. Have you been visiting potential new houses if Trump is elected? No, I haven't. Joyce Bell, what do you really think of Newt Gingrich? Really? Joyce, do you really want to know? I think Newt Gingrich actually began America down the road toward Donald Trump. I mean, I was there when Newt Gingrich came to town in Washington to become and became Speaker of the House. I mean, he was there on Congress before that, but I was there when he became Speaker of the House in 1995. And you know, it was like the whole climate of Washington changed. It was like a cloud, a deepening, darkening cloud came over the entire city. And the tenor of relations between Republicans and Democrats, it became more vicious. That people stopped talking to each other. I remember I had been talking to a congressional committee, an oversight committee, as Secretary of Labor, in just before the change in Congress, and it was civil. Republicans asked me questions, and they were not necessarily always friendly questions, but I responded, and we all got along. And then 2 months later, the same committee, but the composition had changed a little bit because the Republicans with Newt Gingrich had come in, I got questions. I mean, I remember Rick Santorum, who was then a member of Congress, in the middle of my answering some question, I believe it was Rick Santorum, he said, Mr. Secretary, excuse me, are you a communist? And I didn't believe it. I said to my assistant, is he serious? And my assistant said, I'm afraid so. Newt Gingrich began what we are now going through. Emil Torres, what is the bigger implication of Russia's withdrawal from the plutonium disposal treaty? How scared should we be? Emil, it's a good question. I think we should be very concerned. I think it's a big deal because it marks a very explicit, open, conspicuous turning point in terms of Russia's engagement and cooperation with us about nuclear fissile materials. And I think it is a calculated signal that Putin really is angry to the point where he is willing to sacrifice some of the gains that Russia and the United States have made over the last few years, because it's all about power. It's about his own personal power. I mean, Putin is the Russian equivalent of somebody in the United States who's running for president, and I'm not talking about Hillary Clinton. Michael McKeenan, does it make sense for the Clinton campaign and its surrogates to focus so exclusively on Donald Trump and not on the Republicans? Doesn't this give Republicans, other Republicans candidates, a free pass on down-ticket races? Michael, I am concerned about that, frankly. I worry that by making Donald Trump the only villain of the piece and not linking him to the Republican agenda, and a lot of what Donald Trump wants in terms of trickle-down economics and deregulation and repealing Obamacare and going, I mean, everything else is, it's not all the typical Republican agenda, but a lot of it is the old Republican agenda. And by not talking about that Republican agenda, I worry that Hillary Clinton and the Democrats are, in effect, allowing Republicans who are running for the Senate and also for the House to get kind of a free pass by saying, "Oh well, we're not with Trump. We're not that kind of person. We are traditional Republicans, traditional conservatives." No, there is a huge and important overlap. Phyllis Nunn, why isn't climate change in the debates front and center? Phyllis, this is another example. You make Donald Trump and his idiosyncrasies and his character and temperament and bizarre behavior are so much central to the debate right now that we are not talking about inequality, we're not talking about the stagnation of median wages and what to do about it, we're not talking about climate change, we're not talking about the big issues we ought to be talking about, and that means that even if Hillary Clinton is elected, please, she's not going to have the mandate she needs to get on with what needs to be done. That's my fear. All right, can I just share with you candidly my fear? Roxanne Mojer, is that how you pronounce it, Roxanne? You're not sure. What is driving the upward spiral in housing prices if wages are mostly flat? Is publicly owned housing or publicly subsidized or public subsidy the only meaningful intervention? No, Roxanne. What's driving the upward spiral in housing prices is something like what drove it before 2008. That is, you get a lot of speculation. Some of it is foreign money coming in, billionaires around the world. Some of it is people who are stretching themselves, paying much, much a larger percentage of their income than ever before for housing because they expect housing prices will continue to increase. Well, if everybody does that, you know what that is called? It's called a bubble. And those bubbles do burst. And right now we're seeing a widening gap between housing prices and median incomes. And when that gap, housing prices keep on going up, median incomes are not growing that nearly that fast, eventually that gap becomes so large that you have a correction, which is a euphemism for a little bit of a bursting of that housing bubble. So what can we do about it? Well, for one thing, the banks can be a little bit careful. For another thing, though, long term, we've got to have more housing that is moderate. Smart growth means that you have more public transportation, more better and more efficient public transportation, and you cluster your housing nodes around those public transportation nodes. So you can live further away from work, but you can get to work efficiently, and you don't have suburban sprawl. Did I make that clear? It's a complicated idea, but it's really important. Ted Dyer. How can we encourage business investment without allowing so many loopholes? Get big money out of politics, Ted. Susie Johnson, can you explain some of the economic hypocrisies of political parties? Susie, how much time do we have? How much time do you have? Why do so many not so rich vote against their own economic self-interest? Susie, I think the reason they vote against their economic self-interest is that they have been sold a bill of goods by the moneyed interests, Democrats as well as Republicans, more Republicans than Democrats, but both parties, that their major problems have to do with either foreigners or with Republicans, it's playing the race card, that their major problems of the middle class and the working class have to do with the poor and blacks and Latinos, or they're kind of driving a wedge having to do with differences in where, kind of class differences. But, you know, if we came together, and I want to say this, and I've said this before, I want to say it again, if we came together, the bottom 60%, across race, across class, across religion, across all of the divides that have been attempted to be used by the moneyed interest to keep us apart, if we came together and said, we're going to reclaim our democracy and reclaim our economy, we could do it. We could do it. That's what happened 100 years ago, or 120 years ago, during the progressive era of American politics. There is a precedent for this. Next question. Wanda Worstell. Are you a lawyer, as well as your other credentials? Wanda, I practiced law for 2 years, so I suppose you could say, and you know what I was doing? I was assistant to the Solicitor General of the United States, and I argued and briefed Supreme Court cases. I did, and I'm not going to tell you who my boss was. All right, I will. Robert Bork. Okay, I'm revealing something very personal. And Robert Bork, he was my boss. We disagreed on the 1st, 2nd, 4th, 5th, 8th, and 9th amendments to the Constitution. Okay, Greg Davis. Why are so many politicians lawyers? This is another lawyer issue. You're interested in law today. Mm-hmm. Because I was talking about law. This is actually an understanding of how economics, law, and politics are absolutely interactive. They create our political economic system is very important. Greg, why are so many politicians lawyers? How does that affect their lawmaking skills? Well, many politicians are lawyers because law is a study of, if you'll excuse me, epistemology. That is the meaning of words and also categories. There is sort of thinking about and like lawyers. And having the tools with which to make changes in the rules of the game. But ultimately, we're only talking about the rules of the game. And something that I keep saying, and it's very, very important, is that the idea that there's over here a free market, and that over here we have politics and government, is completely wrong. because you can't have a free market without rules of the game. You can't have a free market without law and politics determining what the free market is going to look like, the organization of that free market. And so anybody, economists, or anybody who teaches or takes economics, or anybody who's ideologically attends to believe that there is just a free market out there and we don't need or don't want government, you don't know this basic reality. And this basic reality that government and politics are setting the rules is so important. And I believe that the reason so many people think there is a difference between the free market and politics is because those people who have the power to make changes in the rules don't want you to know that there is actually no free market without those rules. Lauren Seibold, if Trump gets elected, is he a genuine risk to the economy? Or are there enough checks and balances to keep him from doing irreparable damage? Lauren, I don't know. But I don't want to risk it. That is, if Trump is elected president, I could see within 2 years an impeachment vote in the House because he's so overreached his authority and he's acted so crazily. And I could see that impeachment vote confirmed by the Senate. And then I could see him saying, forget it, I'm not leaving. And then what? Linda Vorsinger, if Trump is elected president, how would that impact the rest of the world? Or would it not? The rest of the world, Lauren, is already deeply, deeply worried about the prospect of a President Trump. I hate to even use those two words together, President and Trump. The rest of the world thinks we are completely out of our minds. It doesn't understand that it's the Republican Party that is out of its mind. We have time for just two more questions. All right, Helen Krikorian-Stockhorst. That's an amazing name, Helen. I don't mean to, that's not a disparaging remark. I'm just impressed. Why does the Fed have a former Wall Street chairman and former investment group partner regulating our system? Well, Helen, the Fed, the members of the Fed, are a lot of them are bankers, a lot of them are financiers. I think that there needs to be more people on the Fed who are not part of the banking system, are not bank presidents. I've said that for a long time. They're not bad people on the Fed, but I think that the Fed needs to more accurately reflect where most people are. It is balancing. Remember, what the Fed is doing with monetary policy in terms of setting interest rates is balancing the possibility of inflation against the need for full employment. I mean, that's basically a lot of what it does. And I happen to be on the side of more jobs and more employment. I don't think inflation is a danger at all. I think the Fed is flirting with raising interest rates now. It should not be raising interest rates now. The economy is still too fragile. Sarah Jo, can you talk a bit about your career? How did you end up as Labor Secretary? Sarah Jo, I don't know how I ended up as Labor Secretary. I ended up as Labor Secretary, I suppose, because I knew Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton, and I had written a lot of books, and I was saying things in the late 80s and early 1990s before the Clinton administration, such as, we have to invest in our workforce. We have to invest in education. We have to invest in job training. We've got to invest in infrastructure. We've got to make sure that we put people first, that an economy is not the companies that are in it, because those companies are becoming global. And an economy is not just physical capital, because physical capital is also becoming global. It's not just financial capital, because financial capital is becoming global. An economy can best be defined as the people inside that economy, and their intelligence and their skills and their capacity to innovate and the infrastructure that links us together, that is the definition of an economy. And if we're not making those investments, we are not going to have a successful economy. And one of the things that is frustrating to me is that I was saying that 25 and 30 years ago, and I don't believe that even the Clinton administration did nearly enough to respond to that new reality. But we will. We can. There is time. And I believe that the core of the Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, the progressive movement is to make average working people and the poor the center of our economy where they should be. And on that note, I will see you, remember, 5 weeks to Election Day. And hope you have a very, very good week. See you next week at this time, at this place. Bye.